Well, good morning, Glen Abbey. Here we are in December, the first Sunday of Advent, a joyous time of waiting and anticipation and of great things to come. So glad that you could be here this morning. And we'll begin with sharing the peace of Christ. May the peace of our risen Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
All right, I'm going to ask any minute people to start making their way up. And first of all, many thanks to Candace Sunderland and the crew who transformed the sanctuary into a virtual Christmas wonderland. It looks beautiful and festive, and thank you. And remember, it's not too early to start inviting everyone you know to our family-friendly Christmas Eve at 7 p.m. Oddly enough, on December 24th. It's a shorter service, so that excited kids, young and old, won't be bored. And I know they start getting a little antsy, so we have that all covered, and it's a very enjoyable time for everyone. All right, let the parade begin.
Good morning. I have a question for you, especially for you gentlemen. When was the last time you cleaned out your closet? I thought so. Safety Net is one of the charities that we support here. And they have had an incredible influx of mainly political asylum seekers, most of which are men. And they are absolutely desperate for men's clothing, especially outerwear and socks, new socks and new underwear, and gently used clothing of any kind, but especially outerwear and boots and shoes. We're going to have, in the next couple of weeks, a bin of some sort under the tree. If you have anything you'd like to donate, please bring it and put it under the tree. If you have a lot of stuff, you're welcome to deliver it yourself to Safety Net there. On the South Service Road, just around the corner from Trafalgar. It took me a minute there. They're just around the corner from Trafalgar on the South Safety Road, South Service Road. If you don't have things in your closet and you would like to contribute anyway, they are desperate for new underwear and new socks. So we'll look forward to seeing how much we can help them out. Thank you.
I just wanted to say thank you to all those who did come and help out yet last week with the Christmas decorating, and the men that I had asked for last week to help with some of the heavy lifting and whatnot, and several men stayed and helped with the boxes and whatnot and hefting the tree up to the front here. So thank you very much to everyone who helped.
Good morning. Yesterday there was a very special delivery that was made of the quilt that had been done by the sewing circle in our church. It was accompanied on the journey home by representatives of five United Churches of Oakville, as well as members of our board. It was a moving time to deliver this special quilt to Marilyn Morley. The panel itself was gifted to us in October 22 by Marilyn. The panel is called Journey Home, and it depicts two children of residential schools. I will be telling that story a little bit later. But this story of anticipation in the development of this beautiful quilt is much like the story of Advent. Advent is our time of anticipation, waiting for wonder that we don't even know what will happen. I'm going to be giving each of you, as you leave today, this small booklet. It is scripture readings that are done through Advent, and I'm inviting all that would like to discuss one reading more deeply to join me in a Zoom call. Originally, it was going to be Thursday night. I will have to do it on a Wednesday afternoon, likely at 1 o'clock by Zoom, if you can join. I know that you will deeply be moved by the thoughts and anticipations, the hope, the longing of this particular time. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary. Okay, so we have a very busy week or so ahead. On Tuesday, December 5th, this coming Tuesday, will be the next Tuesday 2:30 tea time conversation and social event that is open to all seniors in the community. Then for December 6th, you can go online to purchase tickets for the Oakville Prayer Breakfast. Now, I've gone to all of them, and I know a lot of you don't. So you might be wondering, like, what do? Eat eggs and pray for 2 hours? No. It's a very nice event where Christians from all over Oakville of different denominations come together. There is a full, delicious breakfast, but there's also music to do with the Christmas season and a guest speaker, and it's quite a time. So if you go to oakvilleprayerbreakfast.com, you can find tickets there. New Member Sunday is next Sunday, December 10th, and this is last call if you're interested in taking this next step of officially becoming a full member. Please email me or speak to me after the service. Now, a reminder, a week from Monday is the annual Christmas Men's Luncheon, and please contact Gary Dobie if you'd like to attend. His email is in my Wednesday message that went out, and you don't have to be a member of the Men's Club to attend this event. We talked about safety net. Oh yes, next Sunday will be our Fair Share food drive, and you'll receive a list during the week of the most needed items for that. So hopefully we can all stay after the service for a cup of coffee, maybe a chat with someone we haven't spoken to before, and get to know some of our new friends. Now, if you would like a special event acknowledged, whether it's a birthday, anniversary, graduation, bar mitzvah, just send me an email. And this upcoming week, we have 3 birthdays to celebrate. On Monday the 4th is our friend Dwayne Stewart. On Wednesday the 6th, is Sandra Thwaites, and I know there's one more. Oh yes, the same day as my lovely wife, Chris, on Wednesday. So let's sing happy birthday to Dwayne, Chris, and Sandra. Dwayne, Chris, and Sandra. Yvonne, please. All right, well, this is a wonderful time of year as we pierce the darkness with light. And it is always a pleasure to have our families do the Advent candle lighting. So I'd like to invite up Jennifer, Chris, Yasmin, and Duncan, please. Thank you very much. This is Yasmin, Duncan, Jennifer, and Chris. Somebody has the lighter for lighting one. Here's a microphone for you.
Thank you so much. This is the first Sunday of Advent, the first day of our journey towards Christmas.
We light this first candle of Advent, the candle of hope, to remind us of the hope God's people felt as they waited for the long-expected Messiah, and the hope that Jesus still gives us in our lives today.
Let's all express our hope by singing verse 1 of hymn 6.
Thank you very much. And we can remain seated. Thank you. thank you very much for starting us off on our Advent journey. Everything you need today you'll find projected on the screen behind me, and we'll begin with the call to worship. The new church year has begun. We may live in times of darkness.
But the light of the world is shining.
We may live in times of trouble. Let us worship God, and we will with the singing of that great Advent hymn, O Come, Emmanuel. Now, we're going to only do verses 1, 2, and 7. The words will be on screen, and for your if you are using a hymn book, it's number 1. Please rise as you are able. Please be seated. And we'll continue with the prayer of confession and invocation that you'll find projected on screen as we all say together. Merciful God, in this time of Advent, we must take stock and start our preparations yet again. Some have forgotten how to hope in miracles. Some get distracted by all the busyness of this season. Please forgive us, Lord. Fill us with your Holy Spirit. Grant us the simple wonder of the shepherds, the intelligent courage of the wise men, and the patient faith of Mary and Joseph, that we may journey with them to Bethlehem and find the good news of a child born for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And the really, really good news of the gospel is that this is a time of preparation, but it's also a time of peace and calm. So rather than put such pressure on ourselves to make sure that it's the perfect Christmas and going crazy out driving in the malls and getting road rage, trying to find a parking space, it's a time to take a deep breath, to worship together, and to remember the true meaning of the season. Well, today we are celebrating the sacrament of Holy Communion. And as always, I remind you that everyone is invited to partake. There's no requirements for membership, no requirements of age. Everyone is welcome, because this is not the table of Glen Abbey United Church. It is not the table of the United Church of Canada. It is the table of Jesus Christ, who invites all of us to eat and drink together. So in the name of the one who said, "I am the bread of life," I invite all of us to eat. In the name of the one who said, "I am the true vine," I invite all of us to drink. In the name of the one who said, "Love one another as I have loved you," I invite all of us to the table of Jesus Christ. And we'll begin with the words of the great Thanksgiving. Glory to God in the highest.
And on earth, peace to all.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to God.
Let us give thanks to God. Let's bow our heads in prayer, please. Blessed are you, gracious God, creator of light, giver of all life, source of love. Even when we turn away from you, you keep faith with us. You send your messengers to prepare the way through the wilderness of our living, to guide us in the path of wholeness, to call us to repent. In Mary, you showed us courage and faith. In the fullness of time, you sent us your greatest gift, Jesus Christ, our Prince of Peace and Herald of Hope. So it is that we join in the Advent prayer of all your people, O come, Emmanuel, as we wait and watch for your coming. And together we proclaim your goodness that we see projected on screen. Let us say together, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And now we gather at this table to remember God's love made flesh in Jesus Christ. Amen. So when we do come together, it's a time of remembrance. And we remember how we saw a little bit of God's reign when Jesus would be with others. And in the upper room on the night before he died, he had supper with his companions. He took a loaf of bread, he gave thanks, and he broke it. And he said, "Take, eat. This is my body broken for you. Whenever you do this in remembrance of me." Then he took a cup, and he poured into it, and he passed it amongst them, saying, "Drink. This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant that is made in my blood. Whenever you do this in remembrance of me." Because through this loaf and this cup, Jesus lives within us, but it's in our words and our deeds and our actions, particularly at this time of year, that Jesus lives among us. Loving God, we rejoice in the gift of your grace, remembering Christ's life and death, proclaiming his resurrection, waiting in hope for his coming again. Grant that in praise and thanksgiving we may so offer ourselves to you that our lives may proclaim this mystery of faith. Let us say together, Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again. Send, O God, your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts, that all who share in this loaf and cup may truly be the body of Christ. All glory is yours, God most holy, now and forever. And as our Savior taught us, let us pray together, saying the words of the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The bread which we break is our communion in the body of Christ. The cup of blessing that is poured out is our communion in the blood of Christ. The gifts of God for the people of God. And I'll remind you that we'll let the choir come down first to partake, and that when you do receive the elements, to please hold on to them, take them back to your seats. That way we can all eat together and then drink together. And if you would like the elements delivered to you in your seat, all you need to do is raise your hand. And I'll ask the servers to come forward, please. So I'll invite the choir to come forward. Blood of Christ shed especially for you, Sue. The blood of Christ shed especially for you, Patrick. The blood of Christ shed especially for you, Margaret.
Thank you very much, dear.
The blood of Christ shed especially for you, Carol. The blood of Christ shed especially for you, Angela.
Thank you.
Maybe we'll switch spots. All is ready, please come forward. Especially for you, Marvin. The blood of Christ shed especially for you, Janet.
That's everybody, I think.
I think so.
Okay.
Good planning. This is the body of Christ, broken for each and every one of us. And as we eat it together, let us give thanks for all the many blessings we've received. And this cup of blessing is the blood of Christ, shed especially for all of us. And as I always say, if you were the only person in need of salvation, Christ still would have died for you. An awesome thing to remember as we drink together in communion. And we'll continue with the prayer after communion that you'll find projected on screen that we'll say together. We give thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us at your table by granting us the presence of Jesus Christ. May we experience hope, peace, joy, and love as we wait in this Advent season. Help us to serve one another and send us forth into the world united in courage and peace, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen. And thanks be to God. The Lord works in mysterious ways. We had exactly the right number of cups of juice today. And thank you to you all who prepared and participated. All right, I think what we'll do is we'll just switch it up for a second if we can. Originally, I wasn't going to have a praise song today, because we usually don't during when we have communion going on. It's only 4 minutes, and it's so perfect for today. So I'm going to invite you to please rise as you're able. If you want to move a little bit, feel free to, and to sing along with this beautiful song of hope. As they say on Romper Room, Mr. Music, please.
Take me back to 8 years old, the little church on a dead end road, with a candle flicker in one hand and Dad's hand in the other. Take me back to silent night, my heart was full and the world was right. 'Cause right now the world looks nothing like those innocent Decembers. These days peace on earth is hard to find, and I need you to remind me one more time. You're still the hope of Christmas. You're still the light when the world looks dark. You're still the hope of Christmas. And you're still the hope of my heart. Watch the snowflakes falling down like a blanket on this town. For a moment we can hardly see the pain this year has brought us. May the sick find healing's touch, may hatred's fight be won with love, and may every heart make room for you, the one who came to save us. 'Cause you're still the hope of Christmas. You're still the light when the world looks dark. You're still the hope of Christmas. And you're still the hope of my heart. Bowed my head to pray tonight, felt my little girl by my side. She slipped her tiny hand in mine, and we both talked to you. And it took me back to 8 years old, my daddy's hand and a story told about heaven's love in the manger low, and a promise that's still true. You're still the hope of Christmas. You're still the light when the world looks dark. You're still the hope of Christmas. And you're still the hope of my heart. You're still the hope of Christmas. You're still the light when the world looks dark. You're still the You're still the hope of my heart.
Please be seated. I thought it was so perfect for today. Couldn't let it go. All right, can I have my young friends come to the front, please? Any kids? People are feeling young, not Florian. Any kids, youths? Whatever you want to call yourselves. Hello, hello, hello. All right, have a seat. Make yourself comfortable. All right, and everybody? Nathan, what you doing way over there, man? Well, yeah, I did say to get comfortable, and that's the only seat that has a back on it. Okay, I'll come see you in a minute. All right, any good news to share this week? Anything going on? Yasmin? You're watching a movie. What movie are you watching? Oh, the new Hunger Games. Katniss Everdeen. Like it. How about you, Duncan?
No.
No? Nothing?
No.
Are you going to watch the movie at least?
No.
No? Are you going to like sit around and?
No.
You're a very positive guy. Hi, Joe. How you doing?
Great.
Yeah? Everything okay?
Yeah.
Anything good this week in particular?
Not good, but bad. I broke both my, I kind of sprained both my wrists.
Yow. Yike. That hurts.
No.
Yow. You okay?
Yeah.
Can you still type?
I can still type, but sometimes it hurts.
Ah, sorry to hear that. So, Nathan. Mr. Comfortable. Anything good this week?
Easter egg?
An Easter egg?
Yeah, I found it.
You found it? I hope it's from this year's Easter egg hunt. You find it in the church or at home?
In the church.
Wow. I thought they vacuumed up all of them. And I don't mean with a vacuum, I mean the kids. Nice. All right, so we're in a whole new time. It's a whole new year. So Happy New Year. I know we usually do that 4 weeks from now, but this is the new church year. So you know how sometimes you get those games that says what's different in the two pictures? What do you see that's different in the church today?
Christmas decorations.
Yes, Christmas decorations. Any of them in particular you notice? Anything? I know you're going to say no.
No.
I knew it. It's like a psychic connection. Anything, Esmeen, that you see?
I don't think so.
All right. Maybe some angels. The choir's kind of looking like angels. Okay, besides having Easter eggs in the church, you notice anything different today?
Advent?
Yeah. We have the Advent candles going. We have the Advent wreath. And that's because this is the time when John the Baptist first came to tell people that somebody was coming. Somebody greater than him. I know Joan will give me the right answer. Who do you think it was who John was telling people was coming?
Jesus.
Perfect. Thank you. And yeah, we look forward to Jesus' birthday. And I know that Chris has lots more for you on that subject. But yeah, this is a time when we start looking forward to it. Not just the presents and the turkey and all that, but if we remember that it's Jesus' birthday coming up, right? All right, let's have a little prayer before you head out. Dear God, we thank you so much for our families and for Jesus. Help us to truly celebrate what Christmas is all about. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, go have a great time with Chris, and we'll see you after. There she goes. Let's bow our heads in prayer, please. Loving God, as we come into this time, it should be a time of celebration. We know it can be a time of mixed emotions. There's a lot going on, and we may find ourselves just so consumed by worldly matters that sometimes we find it hard to concentrate on what really matters. And we know that you have a word for everyone here today, whether the scripture readings, maybe the song we just sang, or perhaps as well in those quiet moments as we look upon these beautiful decorations that celebrate light coming into this world. So we ask you to open up our ears and our eyes. Let us recognize what it is you're trying to say to each and every one of us. Then help us to do something about it. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And I would like to invite Donna McNaught forward for our reading this morning, please.
The Old Testament scripture is taken from Isaiah chapter 40, verses 1 to 9. Comfort my people, says our God. Comfort them. Encourage the people of Jerusalem. Tell them they have suffered long enough and their sins are now forgiven. I have punished them in full for all their sins. A voice cries out, prepare in the wilderness a road for the Lord. Clear the way in the desert for our God. Fill every valley, level every mountain. The hills will become a plain, and the rough country will be made smooth. Then the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all people will see it. The Lord himself has promised this. A voice cries out, proclaim a message. What message shall I proclaim? I ask. Proclaim that all human beings are like grass. They last no longer than wild flowers. Grass withers and flowers fade when the Lord sends the wind blowing over them. People are no more enduring than grass. Yes, grass withers and flowers fade, but the word of our God endures forever. Jerusalem, go up on a high mountain and proclaim the good news. Call out with a loud voice, Zion, announce the good news. Speak out and do not be afraid. Tell the towns of Judah that their God is coming. The responsive psalm is Psalm 67 in Voices United, page 786. Be gracious unto us, O God, and bless us, and let the light of your face shine upon us.
That your ways may be known upon earth, your saving power among all nations.
Let the nations be glad and sing for joy.
For you judge the peoples righteously and guide the nations of the earth.
The earth has yielded its harvest, and you, our God, have blessed us.
Your blessing, O God, be upon us. May all the ends of the earth revere you.
Bless these words, O God.
Thank you, Donna, for a fine job on the readings. Appreciate it. Now, our anthem today, the praise song was a perfect one for today, as is the anthem. It's titled, Light the Advent Candles.
Let them be an offering fit for
Once again, the gospel reading this morning comes right from the start, the Gospel of Mark, chapter 1, verses 1 through 8. And this is what Mark recorded, and we listen for the word of God. The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in the prophet Isaiah, "See, I am sending my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way. The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight.'" John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the River Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." Thanks be to God for these very, very holy words. Well, my message today is titled, "Can We Please Have Some Hope?" Now, some folks may have medical or family situations that are not resolving as quickly as they had hoped. And it's not easy to maintain a positive outlook. Remember a year ago, we hoped that the Russian invasion of Ukraine would soon be over, but it still wages on. It may not be front page news, but it's still happening. Recently, we heard that climate change has caused the world's largest ice shelf to break off from Antarctica and to be on the move, and it is the size of Greater Montreal. Last week, with the temporary ceasefire and release of some of the Israeli hostages and Palestinian prisoners, we may have hoped that this truce would be extended, but they are right back at it. And shockingly, the Hamas leader said this week that October the 7th was only a rehearsal. So I think we are all thoroughly entitled to raise our eyes and hands toward heaven and ask God, "Can we please have some hope?" Well, as Jennifer, Chris, Yasmin, and Duncan told us during the candle lighting, this first Sunday of Advent is the Sunday of hope. It's also the first Sunday of the new church year. We look forward to it coming, but this can be such a complicated time of year and such a time of contrast. We face the next 4 weeks with an air of anticipation. Sometimes it gets mixed in with anxiety. We attend celebrations, and we know that Advent is a time of preparations. But it's also a time to take a hard look at ourselves and see where it is that maybe we need to change. December is the time of year where there may be the least daylight, but Advent is when we move from darkness and light candles, like our families will be doing each Sunday as we move into receiving the light of Christ. Well, usually in December, I tend to stray from the lectionary and concentrate on the Gospel of Luke. We do this year after year, so I thought this year I'd follow the lectionary with adjustments by a week because of us only having 3 Sundays. And so we're going to have readings from Mark this week, John the next week, and Luke the week after. And from our readings this morning, it's clear that people at the time needed to change their ways, and they were all in need of hope. It was also clear there's a huge change between how God is understood from the Old to the New Testaments. Now, people sometimes think that prophets are just people who foretell the future. But in the Bible, prophets were the chosen ones to deliver God's message to the people. The prophet Isaiah spoke God's message to tell the people of Jerusalem they have suffered long enough and their sins are now forgiven. I have punished them in full for all their sins. Well, we've talked before about how there's 613 commandments in the Old Testament, plenty of opportunity for sin, but they had always been taught that God punished them for their sins. Well, as Donna read so well for us, Isaiah prophesied, proclaimed that all human beings are like grass. They last no longer than wild flowers. Grass withers and flowers fade when the Lord sends the wind blowing over them. People are no more enduring than grass. And we notice something. There's no message of eternal life there. It's just you live, you wither, you fade, you die. Just like the flowers and the grass. Well, unfortunately, some folks today still relate to God this way. When things go wrong, they wonder, what have I done that God would want to punish me so much? Well, the truth of the matter is that God's blessings apply to this life, but judgment and mercy, they apply more to the next life. Our legal system punishes those who break the laws of society, but eternal matters, they're up to God. Now, in the New Testament and in Mark today, John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. So we notice something here. There's no denying that people sin, but there's no mention of God punishing them for it. Now, as you might remember, John was related to Jesus as their mothers, Elizabeth and Mary, were cousins. And we know there was only a few months difference in their ages, but there was a great difference in their personalities. John, he was a wild man. He was a wild man. He was one of those wild prophets whose abrasive nature influenced a great many people. And eventually, it cost him his head. He ate locusts and wild honey and spent his time in the wilderness prophesying and baptizing people in the Jordan River. That's a pretty important message to be proclaiming. And it might be surprising that John lived in the wilderness instead of going into Jerusalem and spreading the message there. But throughout Israel's history, the wilderness had been a place where God shaped people. Prophets did a lot of their work in the wilderness. We remember Jesus would soon be tested in the wilderness. And you know something? God continues to work in the wilderness of our lives today. It seems we're most open to hearing God's word when life seems most barren. Because if we're honest, when things go too well, it's easy to forget the source of our blessings, but when we're in need, we frequently search out God. G.K. Chesterton once wrote, "Hope means hoping when things are hopeless, or it is no virtue at all." As long as matters are really hopeful, hope is mere flattery or platitude. It is only when everything is hopeless that hope begins to be a strength. And it is God that is our source of hope when all around us seems hopeless. Well, whenever we read something in the New Testament that fulfills a writing in the Old Testament, it's important to put in perspective and realize the book of Isaiah was written 700 years before Christ was born. 700 years. And Isaiah wrote, "Every valley must be filled up and mountain leveled off." Now, God does not need people getting out there with pickaxes and shovels to create a highway through the desert for him. It's the wilderness of our lives and the deserts of our hearts that require the preparation. If we're going to prepare for the Lord's coming, especially at this time of year, our preparation must involve some sort of spiritual discipline, such as prayer, the reading of Scripture, or like the booklets that Mary will be handing out with the Advent devotionals, proper worship, and trying to live purer lives. And that voice in the wilderness doesn't specify what our preparation should be. It's enough for people to know that they need to prepare for the Lord's coming. All right, so people from the whole Judean countryside, and it says all the people in Jerusalem were going out to him, to John, to be baptized in the River Jordan, and they were confessing their sins. And this is a huge turning point in the Bible and all of history. No words of having been punished for their sins, just turn away from them, also known as repenting, be baptized, and we remember that it's the water baptism that John was using to wash their sins away and be forgiven by God. But then John tells them something that they're amazed by. He told them that one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. Well, this would be the time of God breaking in to this rundown old world as Jesus Christ. And when he did, everything changed. Everything changed. God became understood as a good father, not some prison warden whose goal was to punish wrongdoers. And that eternal life means that we are not as temporary as the wildflowers and grass. And as we prepare our homes for the Christmas season, we need to prepare our hearts as well, to clear out all the clutter that becomes obstacles to us being the people that God intended us to be. And it begins with seeing ourselves clearly, by taking time to really take stock of where we're at. We can ask ourselves a lot of questions. Are we as generous as we should be? I'm not just talking financially, but with praise and with compliments and general goodwill, not just in the church, but to people in general. And if we're going to prepare ourselves, if we're going to get ready for the coming of the Lord, we need to examine our own faults and then change our ways and then ask forgiveness. Forgiveness of those we have wronged and forgiveness from God. And something that is just as true today as it was in Isaiah's time and in John the Baptist's time, people still need forgiveness. And thankfully, God still forgives, which gives us hope. Now, the last part of our reading from Isaiah, it offers us real hope. Go up on a high mountain and proclaim the good news. Call out with a loud voice, Zion, announce the good news. Speak out and do not be afraid. Tell the towns of Judah that their God is coming. And today, as we incorporate a little Christmas into each service, we're going to be singing Go Tell It on the Mountain for our closing hymn. And there's good news right here. Right in this place, because we can see the light of Christ shining here. With all the problems in the world, with an increasingly secular society, with the huge roadblock that the pandemic was, we are welcoming more and more friends who are new and those who are back each week to this church family. That is a light that the darkness could not overcome. Our Christmas Eve service, it reminds us of the hope that Jesus brings to this world, that people are open to hearing the message one more time. And we bask in the wonder of the candlelight. That's one of my favorite moments of the entire year, when we sing Silent Night and all the candles. And that joyous sound that results when so many voices sing together. But then there's also our generosity towards others through our outreach committee, to Fair Share Food Bank, to Safety Net, to Kerr Street Mission, to Rock, to Hope Place, Roofs for the Roofless, amongst others. Taking the step forward to help all those folks with no other thanks but knowing that we're doing what God wants. That is real hope. And we see in action the good news and the great hearts that make up this church family. In the midst of all the chaos going on in the world, today marks the beginning of the season of Advent, a time of preparation, a time of going towards the coming again of the Messiah, a time of great expectation and great anticipation. But exactly what are we getting ready for? Are we preparing our hearts and our spirits to receive again the coming of the Christ child into this world? Or are we preparing for yet another month-long shopping spree? Midnight madness and the credit card bills we'll get in January. John is telling us to be ready because the one who is more powerful is coming. Advent, it's a time of preparation, but so much more than the house or the gifts or the tree. It's the time to prepare our hearts, to put ourselves in right relationship with people around us, and most importantly, with God. Claire Booth Luce once wrote, "There are no hopeless situations. There are only people who have grown hopeless about them." This is a time to be hopeful, a time to be strong, a time to be unified for ourselves, our family, for each other, because with God, nothing is impossible. Now, if things are going well for us now, let's not become complacent. Let's tend to our hearts and our relationships and take nothing and no one for granted. And by doing this, we'll have hope that things will even get better. So people, get ready in this Advent season. God is coming. And because of this, we really can have some hope. And for all of this, we say thanks be to God. Amen. Well, this is our time of offering. A reminder to those at home, it's easy to make e-transfers to donations at glenabbeyunitedchurch.com. And for everyone that's here, it is wonderful to see you today. To hear your voices is an amazing thing. And for the time that we spend together and spreading God's love into the community, for the talents that we each bring that probably nobody else can do, and for your financial gifts that will be taken up now, God bless you and thank you. So something else that we're changing for the Advent and Christmas season is our offertory. And just a reminder that in the last verse, it's, "Yet what I can I give him." Because everybody wants to say, "What can I give him?" It's, "Yet what I can I give him," in the last line. Sorry. All right, please rise as you're able for the offertory.
If I were
Well done. Let's bow our heads for the blessing. Loving God, we do give you thanks for the many, many blessings you have given to us, and we try to give back a little. And so we do spend time together, both during the service and afterwards, getting to know folks and spreading your love. We do bring our talents that we can do things that you need done for your work. And then as well, we bring our financial gifts, and we pray that all of these may be blessed and always, always suit your purpose for this world. We pray this all in the glorious name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. Thank you. Let's bow our heads in prayer, please. Loving God, as we take a look at the world around us, we know that in some areas it would be so difficult for the people to have hope. Where rockets fire and bombs explode and guns are shooting and people are suffering, we ask that somehow they may have hope, that cooler minds will prevail, that somehow things can come to a peaceful end and go well into the future. And that is in so many places, not just Ukraine and Russia and Gaza and Israel, also places that we don't hear about, but there is stuff going on. Lord, please be with them and help these people to get through. Comfort them in their loss. As the prophet Isaiah said, comfort my people, comfort. And then closer to home, we think of people, and we think of the friends and family of Dorothy Brisden, who passed away this week. She was a member here, and her funeral will be on Thursday. We think about those who are mourning, those who are ill, those who are recovering from surgery or looking towards having surgery. Be with all of them. Give them hope, lift their spirits that things will get better, and bless as well the people around them who lift them up, strengthen them so that they can be messengers of your good news. Lord, there are things that are very, very personal that we each have going on in our lives. We may be searching for clarity. We may be searching for comfort. Perhaps it's a time of celebration. No matter what it is, there are some things we just feel we can't discuss with others. But we know that you are ready to listen. So in the silence of these moments, we lift to you our silent prayers. And when you feel the time is right, no matter how you choose to speak to us, Lord, we so look forward to your answer. And we give you so much thanks for this church, a place where people of common mind and spirit can come together to worship you, to celebrate the real reason for the season, and that is the coming of Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray today. Amen. Well, some ministers are really, really stubborn. And they do Advent only until Christmas Eve, and no trace of Christmas until we get there. I'm not that guy. We're going to have a little Christmas today, and we're going to have more as December rolls on. So as promised, for you're now going to sing hymn number 43, Go Tell It on the Mountain, number 43. Please rise as you are able.
Christ is born. The shepherds tell
You sounded great. Choir practice, Tuesday night, 7 o'clock. So you will get to hear all your favorite Christmas carols during the season. We're going to ramp it up as we go along. Actually, 2 weeks from today, after the service on the 17th, the social committee is presenting a Christmas carol sing with cider right after the service. So that'll be a fun time to plan on staying for. Before we have these, I'll ask you to keep standing. We'll be singing Go Now in Peace in a moment. Before we do, a few thank yous to Yvonne and the choir, as always, for your music leadership, especially coming into this wonderful season. At the back, our AV team of John and Richard, thank you so much for spreading the message to all those who can't be here today. For everyone who took part in preparing the elements and serving, the greeting, Donna reading, a lot of things happened to make this happen on a Sunday morning. But the main thing that happens is you being here. It is wonderful to see you. I am so glad that you're here today. So we're going to sing Go Now in Peace, and then we'll have the final blessing. So go into this month of December, this time of Advent, with hope and joy in our hearts. Don't worry if the tree's not perfect and the lights aren't quite right. It doesn't matter. What matters is how our heart and our hope is. And may the generous love of God, the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the guidance and strength and comfort of the Holy Spirit be with you and all whom you love this week and forevermore. Amen. Hope you have time to stay for coffee. It is wonderful to see you all, and I look forward to seeing you next week.